It's a pleasure again to have Jerry Brewer speak to us. It's been a real pleasure having Jerry and his good wife, and the Tarbits are with us, Dub's with us, and for one time, I'm not the oldest guy in the room. Jerry was introduced this morning. He was born in Childress, Texas, and that counts for a lot because he started out as a Texan, so we will welcome him back someday. The important thing that besides all his experience is he's married to the former Shirlene Holly, and it's good to have her with us. Yeah, they've got 6 children, 17 grandchildren, and here's where it really gets good, 3 and soon to be 4 great-grandchildren. Jerry currently preaches for the Northeast Church of Christ in Elk City, Oklahoma. Jerry, come talk to us.
Thank you, Brother Roth, and it is a joy to be in the Roth home. Buddy and Brunel are gracious and wonderful hosts, and I'm kind of like Buddy. It's nice not to be the oldest. In fact, me and him are at the bottom. You start up here with Don Tarbit, and then you got Dub, and then, well, okay, me, and then Buddy. It's a joy to be back. This is sort of like a Sunday. You know, I preached this morning, now I'm preaching this afternoon. So I just feel like that this is Sunday. We are talking about the fatal error on the doctrine of being filled with the Spirit. Filled with the Spirit. The doctrine that men today are Spirit-filled, or filled with the Spirit, is one of those doctrines that was once peculiar to Pentecostalism. In fact, Pentecostalism used to have lots of peculiar doctrines. But now, that one, plus a lot of others, have become trans-denominational. And even churches of Christ, who ought to know better. Well, we say they ought to know better. They can call themselves churches of Christ, but if they don't study the Bible, they're ignorant. And they don't know better. They ought to. If you're going to claim to be a follower of Christ, you need to study the Bible and not be ignorant about Christ. But they describe themselves as Spirit-filled. All you got to do is surf around the internet. I do that. And I did that for this because I'd seen some of these before. That doctrine is fatal to its adherents because it's false. It's a false doctrine. There is not a single individual today who is Spirit-filled as described in the New Testament. It's part and parcel of another gospel that Paul condemned. He said there'd be some that trouble you would preach another gospel, though there's not another. He said there's not another gospel. There's only one. Though men preach any other gospel unto you than that which you've received, let him be accursed. This doctrine of being Spirit-filled is false because it implies other false doctrines. First of all, that there is continuing revelation from God today. That's what it implies. That God is still speaking to men in a direct way. And that, number two, the New Testament is not God's final revelation to man. Jude said in Jude 3, the faith has been once delivered. Contend for the faith that has been once, and that means once and for all time, delivered. If men are Spirit-filled today, God is still delivering the faith. So that doctrine is false. And number three, if that doctrine is true, I mean, that doctrine being Spirit-filled implies implies that miracles are still being performed today. Spirit-filled men did that in the first century. And number four, it implies that the Holy Spirit did not guide the apostles into all truth. That's what that doctrine of being spirit-filled today implies. Now, I looked around the internet and I found some churches that, and you'll find a lot more. This is not an exhaustive list. This is just a sample of what I'm talking about. Churches of Christ. The very first one I remember seeing was the Tamarack Road Church in Altus, Oklahoma. Tamarack Road is a liberal southwestern Oklahoma church, 55 miles south of where we live. They used to be called the Thomas Street Church in Altus, but now they are the Tamarack Road. And I hope there's some of them listening on the internet up there in Oklahoma, because that church is liberal. It's apostate. But on their website, they call themselves Spirit-filled. They are a Spirit-filled church. Well, there's another one still north of us here, where I live, be south of us, the Highland Oaks Church in Dallas. They, on their website, they claim to be Spirit-filled. They say, as God's family, we live in a house filled with the Spirit. The Spirit is what moves our house from being a simple space to being a home. Now listen to this. here's some of that Orwellian doublespeak obfuscation that folks that Brother Denham was talking about, they love to obfuscate like this. Listen to this. In this home, the Spirit enables us to become a people who pursue the heart of God with intentionality and purpose. What? The Spirit enables them to do that. The Spirit's leading them. They are Spirit-filled, living the Christian life with the aid of the Holy Spirit. That's what Brother Denham talked about in the last hour. And that's what denominations teach, and that's what a lot of people who claim to be members of the church teach. They do that at Highland Oaks in Dallas. The West Link Church of Christ in Wichita, Kansas, they claim to be Spirit-filled. Then there's one called The Branch. This is a denomination that's built upon the ruins of the former Farmers Branch, Texas Church of Christ. But this is a denomination. They can call themselves a Church of Christ, but they're a denomination. They have either three or four campuses, and they have elders overseeing all these. It's a hierarchical denomination, I guess, is what you could call that. But these are all people who say, and these are churches of Christ, or claim to be. I'm sure they don't have any candlesticks left, but they claim to be churches of Christ, and they claim to be Spirit-filled. Filled with the Spirit. Without exception, in the New Testament, that phrase is a synonym for miraculous powers. Now I want to read you what Brother Franklin Camp wrote about that. One of my favorite books. Did you ever get a book that you received and you put it aside and you didn't read it for a while? Have you ever done that? Did you ever put one up that you received and you didn't read it for, say, 25 or 30 years? I can't remember when I first read this book, but I received it from my brother and my sister-in-law in 1974, because it's inscribed to me. When Brother Camp came and held a meeting where they lived there at Elk City, and they bought his book on the work of the Holy Spirit, gave it to me. Just a few years ago, I thought, I need to read that book. I did, and that is one of my prized books in my library, is Brother Camp's book. And here's what he had to say. The phrase "filled with the Spirit" denotes inspiration or miraculous power. In the Scriptures, to be filled with the Spirit commonly signifies that degree of inspiration by which the ancient prophets spoke. Accordingly, in this chapter, he's talking about Luke 1, it's applied to Elizabeth, to Mary, to Zacharias, and in each case, a reference to inspiration. Filled with the Spirit. We're going to look at that phrase both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Well, first of all, as it's used in the Old Testament. In constructing the tabernacle, and I think it's only in three passages in all the Old Testament that that phrase is used, or its equivalent. In constructing the tabernacle and all the accoutrements and things necessary for conducting worship, Moses was given specifications for the garments to be worn by Aaron and his sons. And God told Moses, "And thou shalt speak unto all that are wise hearted, whom I have filled with the spirit of wisdom, that they may make Aaron's garments to consecrate him, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office." Exodus 26:3. Those who were wise hearted were those whom God had filled with the spirit of wisdom. In the New Testament, this phrase is used by the apostles when instructing brethren to select men to serve in the daily ministration. "Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business." Acts 6:3. Among those chosen was Stephen, of whom it was later said, as he preached to the unbelieving Jews, "And they were not able to resist the wisdom and spirit by which he spake." Acts 6:10. Full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom indicated miraculous ability, and one of those abilities was wisdom. That's the same terminology used of those wise-hearted ones who were charged with making Aaron's garments. The tabernacle, the furniture, structure, the ark, mercy seat, were also constructed by men who were miraculously endowed or filled with the Spirit. "The Lord spake unto Moses, saying, See, I have called by name Bezaleel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding, knowledge, manner of workmanship, to devise cunning works, to work in gold, silver, set them, and in carving of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship. And I, behold, I have given him Aholiab, the son of Ahizamak, of the tribe of Dan, and in the hearts of all that are wise-hearted, I have put wisdom, that they may make all that I have commanded thee." I have filled him with the Spirit of God. Exodus 31, verses 2 through 6. He was filled with the Spirit of God. He was miraculously endowed. That endowment inspired him with wisdom, understanding, and knowledge to do the work to which he was called. That's precisely what the phrase "filled with the Spirit" meant in this case. And when Aholiab and the other wise ones or wise-hearted ones were given wisdom, that meant miraculous wisdom in order to perform their duties as well. That point was later reiterated by Moses when he actually called those men to the work of God in Exodus 35, 30, and 31, and 34 through 35a. "See, the Lord hath called by name Bezaleel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and hath filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding and knowledge and all manner of workmanship, and he hath put in his heart that he may teach both he and Aholiab, the son of Ahizamak of the tribe of Judah, that he hath them hath he filled with wisdom of heart to work all manner of work." These three passages from the book of Exodus are the only places in the New and the Old Testament where the term "filled with the Spirit" or variations thereof are found. Notice the words wisdom, understanding, knowledge. These are all miraculous, and that term, or terminology is later found in the New Testament, where men were filled with the Spirit. So now here it is in the New Testament. Three places in the Old Testament we've looked at the phrase filled with the Spirit. It meant miraculous ability. New Testament, we come to there. The phrase filled with the Holy Ghost occurs three times in the first chapter of Luke. Its first occurrence referred to John the Baptizer when the angel announced his birth to Zechariah. Fear not, Zechariah, for thy prayer is heard. Thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. Thou shalt have great joy and gladness. Many shall rejoice at his birth, for he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. Luke 1:13b-15. When the angel announced that John would be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb, that meant John would be inspired. John didn't work any miracles, but he was miraculously endowed to speak the word of God. He was an inspired man. He was filled with the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. He was to preach the baptism of repentance for the remission of sin, Mark 1:4, and his preaching was inspired. He was a messenger sent from God, Mark 1:2. His work necessitated inspiration, and that was expressed in the words, he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. All right, the second time that phrase is found in the New Testament, filled with the Holy Ghost, it's attributed to John's mother, Elizabeth. First, the angel told Zechariah, John will be filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, secondly, we find that that phrase, filled with the Holy Ghost, concerns Elizabeth. Upon learning she would bear the Son of God, Mary visited her cousin Elizabeth. You see, Mary, Jesus' mother, and Elizabeth, John's mother, were cousins. And when she learned that she was going to bear the Son of God, Mary went to visit Elizabeth. And in Luke 1, beginning verse 41, it says, it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. And she spake out with a loud voice and said, blessed art thou among women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And whence is this to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from the Lord. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. What did she do? She spoke. She prophesied. If you'll look through men receiving the Holy Spirit, receiving the Holy Ghost through the Bible, you'll find in an overwhelming number of instances, the first thing they did was speak. They prophesied. That is an inspired prophecy. And she spoke. Blessed art thou among women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb. Whence is this to me that the mother of my Lord? How did she know that Mary was bearing her Lord? She was an inspired woman. She was filled with the Holy Ghost. She knew that. That's inspiration. And she said, the babe leaped in my womb. Well, that wasn't the natural movement of a baby. A baby will move in the womb. We all know that. This wasn't a natural movement. She said, the baby leaped in my womb. This was a miraculous leap. And then, being filled with the Holy Ghost, she said the Lord would perform the things he told Mary. All of these things. So the babe leaping in Elizabeth's womb, the blessing of Mary and her prophesying were all miraculous. Filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with the Spirit, and filled with the Holy Ghost are terms of identical meaning and all refer to the person who is miraculously endowed in the Bible. Filled with the Holy Ghost is found The third time in Luke 1:67, his father, Zechariah, John's father, was filled with the Holy Ghost and did what? He prophesied. He spoke. The result about Zechariah being filled with the Holy Spirit was an inspired prophecy. He was miraculously gifted. You know, people talk about these. I see these brethren, and these same ones that have this silliness on their websites, they'll say, well, you know, we need to discover our gifts. We are all gifted. We need to discover those gifts. What do you suppose in the first century those, and they're talking about miraculous things. Don't let them kid you. That's what they're talking about. The Holy Spirit will lead them to. Well, what do you suppose when the apostle laid his hands on a man in the first century and the apostle said, now you've got a spiritual gift, and this man goes, sure wish I knew what it was. I need to discover it. How can I discover my gift? Well, the Holy Spirit, Paul said, gave to those gifts, distributed them as he would and as he did. And a man knew what his gift was. The silliness today that, well, we need to discover our gifts. There are no spiritual gifts as far as miraculous things today. Filled with the Holy Ghost appears again at the beginning of the gospel dispensation, Acts 2. We know that. And the day of Pentecost was fully come. They were all with one accord in one place, Acts 2 says. And there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. There's that word. There's that phrase. Filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. What was the result of being filled with the Spirit there? Miraculous. Speaking with other tongues, languages they had not learned. They spoke in languages they had not studied. That was miraculous. That amazed their hearers. The hearers said, look. And there were men from every nation. Acts 2 says there were devout men at Jerusalem, dwelling in Jerusalem, out of every nation among heaven. And they talked about being Cretes and Arabians and so forth. And they said, how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? How is that? Aren't these men Galileans? How do they know how to speak like we do? It's a miraculous thing. Why and how did they do that? They were filled with the Spirit. That's what the Bible says. They were filled with the Spirit. Then Peter stood up and preached to those who were assembled at the occurrence of this miracle, and his sermon was inspired of the Holy Spirit, according to the promise Jesus made to the apostles in John 14:26. He shall reveal all things to you and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I've said. He'll guide you into all truth, John 16:13. And he did. And Peter spoke, and he preached, and men became Christians. Well, the next use of this phrase, filled with the Holy Ghost, is found at the appearance of Peter and John before the Sanhedrin. This is a little bit later in Acts 4. The Sadducees, of course, they had the high priest, and they ran the show, and they didn't believe in the resurrection. Of course, the apostles were preaching the resurrection, so they had them arrested, brought before the council. They were going to silence the apostles. And Acts 4:7-10 says, when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power, by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, you rulers of the people and the elders of Israel, if we be this day examined of the good deed done to this impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, that's not very loving to accuse them of that, but they did it anyway, whom ye have crucified, whom God raised from the dead, boy, that's rubbing it in. They didn't believe in the resurrection. That's rubbing it in. Even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. Now, I want you to notice that. And I will admit, not only did I let a book lay in my library for maybe 20 or 25 years before I read it, but I have read across Bible passages all of my life, and it really didn't click. Have you ever done that? The Bible, you can always learn something new in the Bible. And in this passage where it said, they were before the council, and it says, Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said. And I remember, some years ago, I was reading across that, and I had read that for a long time. And I thought, wait a minute. Why did he say, what does it mean, Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost? Why did Luke write that? Why didn't he just say, then Peter stood up and said this? Well, I'll tell you why. I learned at that time. I did learn something. It indicated that what Peter said, or what he was about to say, was by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, who was giving him words at that very moment to reply to the council in fulfillment of the promise Jesus had made. When he said in Matthew 10 that they would be brought before governors and counselors for his sake, he told them, but when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what ye shall speak, for it shall be given you in that same hour what ye shall speak, for it is not you that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. Matthew 10:19. Why did Luke write, Peter filled with the Holy Ghost? He was saying, remember what Jesus said? This is a miraculous thing. That's why Peter, he said Peter stood up filled with the Holy Ghost and answered him, because those words weren't Peter's selection. Those were words the Holy Spirit selected at that time for Peter to answer to those men of the Sanhedrin. Peter and John were threatened. They were released by the council. Next time we have the phrase filled with the Holy Ghost or filled with the Holy Spirit is Acts 4:23-30. When they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. They did what when they were filled with the Holy Ghost? They spake the word of God with boldness. It's inspired preaching. See the pattern? Being filled with the Holy Ghost resulted in their speaking and speaking with boldness. They were inspired and miraculously emboldened to preach the gospel. When Ananias entered the house where Saul of Tarsus was praying in Damascus, after the Lord appeared to him on the road, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way thou camest, sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. Acts 9:17. In this instance, filled with the Holy Ghost meant that Saul, who later became the Apostle Paul, would receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit to make him an apostle. Baptism of the Holy Spirit in order to make him an apostle. That was sent directly from heaven. Now, Ananias was filled with the Spirit. How do we know that? He could work a miracle. He did. He had the gift of healing. And the restoration of Saul's sight was by his hands. Acts 9:12. So we know he was filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, Ananias being filled with the Holy Ghost didn't make him an apostle. Being filled with the Holy Ghost simply indicated miraculous ability, whether it was the ability to cure a person of blindness, or whether it was the ability to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, to the ability to make one an apostle. The ones that had spiritual gifts, while said to be filled with the Spirit, did not have all the powers the apostles did. That's what Brother Camp wrote. The difference between the apostles and those who had spiritual gifts through laying on of the hands were not that the apostles were filled with the Spirit while those having spiritual gifts were not. The difference was in the power possessed by the apostles in comparison to others who had spiritual gifts. Just as simple as that. On the first preaching tour of Saul and Barnabas, recorded in Acts 13, they encountered a Jew named Bar-Jesus who was a false prophet. And he was trying to turn Sergius Paulus from the faith. Then Saul, this is Acts 13, verses 9 through 11, Saul, who is called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, there it is, set his eyes on him and said, O thou full of all subtlety and mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now behold, the hand of the Lord is on thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for this evening. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and went around seeking someone to lead him by the hand. Filled with the Holy Ghost, Paul spoke by inspiration and pronounced the miraculous temporary blindness of the false prophet. Filled with the Holy Spirit meant that he had miraculous ability. As in every other case in the Bible. The next occurrence, Acts 13, 52, the disciples were filled with joy in the Holy Ghost. That's all it says there. Someone said, well, it didn't say anything about being miraculous. Doesn't have to. In Acts, the second chapter, they cried out and said, men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter said, repent and be baptized. Jesus said, he that believeth and is baptized. Why didn't Peter say repent? Well, they already did. Believe. They already did. They wouldn't have cried out. It's taken for granted. We know that. And by what the lawyers call a preponderance of evidence, where it's shown that in the other places in the New Testament, filled with the Holy Spirit means miraculous, then that's what it means here. That's what it means here. Paul said he baptized the household of Stephanus, 1 Corinthians 1:16. But he didn't say Stephanus believed, but we know Stephanus had to believe, don't we? We know he had to. Last place in the New Testament where filled with the Spirit is found is in Paul's epistle to the church at Ephesus. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. This is miraculous. Now the conclusion that this is miraculous in no way negates the command to sing and make melody in the heart. Among the gifts distributed by the Holy Spirit in the infancy of the church was inspired singing. Here, Brother Camp again. The objection may be raised that these verses speak of singing, therefore they cannot include miraculous gifts. Is this a valid objection? Look at the clear statement that says there was inspired singing. How is it then, brethren, when you come together, every one of you hath a psalm, hath a doctrine, hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation? Let all things be done unto edifying, 1 Corinthians 14:26. The regulation, the chapter that regulates spiritual gifts. The psalm here can only mean an inspired psalm, as everything else referred to in the verse was miraculous. Indeed, how could pagans who had no Old Testament and the New Testament was not yet written have been able to sing a psalm unless it was inspired? While there were miraculous gifts, the services of the assemblies were under the complete direction of the Spirit through the use of these gifts. Now, it's been objected that Ephesians 5:18 is a command to be filled with the Spirit and therefore cannot be miraculous. Is it true no one was ever commanded to be filled with the Spirit when the miraculous operation of the Spirit was involved? The answer is no. This is Brother Camp. Wherefore I put thee in remembrance to stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on my hands. 2 Timothy 1:6. 1 Corinthians 13 shows the mind and proper motive of the men were needed in the use of miraculous gifts. Since this was true in connection with spiritual gifts, there is nothing strange about those having them being commanded to be filled with the Spirit or to stir up the gift. In 2 Timothy 1:6, we have the positive command to Timothy in the use of the spiritual gift, to stir up the gift. Now, in 1 Timothy 4:14, we have the negative of that same thing. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy. Now, if Timothy was told to not neglect the spiritual gift, but stir up the gift, should one be surprised to find the church being commanded, that had spiritual gifts, being commanded to not neglect or stir up the gift it had? To be filled with the Spirit, Ephesians 5:18, just another way of stating the same thing that Paul told Timothy. The conclusions drawn by Brother Camp on Ephesians 5:18 and 19, I believe, are sound, and in no way create a problem when using that passage to prove that singing is the only kind of music that God accepts in worship. Whether the song was inspired in the first century or sung from a book as we do in our time, God's silence on mechanical instruments still prohibits their use. Anyone today who makes the claim that he is filled with the Spirit is either a deliberate liar, deceived, or just plain ignorant of the Bible. We've shown that in every case, in both the Old and New Testaments, where the phrase filled with the Spirit or filled with the Holy Ghost or its equivalent is used, it refers to miraculous operation. To affirm that today denies the all-sufficiency of the Scriptures. Paul said, all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God, profitable for doctrine, reproof, for correction, instruction in righteousness. The man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Peter wrote, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness. In 2 Peter 1:3, and Jude wrote that the faith, that body of truth, which is the New Testament, has been once and for all delivered unto the saints. Those today who claim to be filled with the Spirit deny that the Scriptures make us complete. They deny that we have all things necessary to life and godliness, and they deny that the faith has been once delivered unto the saints. Because being filled with the Spirit was in that period of time when men were inspired. Inspiration to deliver the Word of God required confirmation. That is, they confirmed what they spoke by the miracles they performed. Hebrews 2, 1 through 4. God also that was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, God also working with them, both with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. They deny that the miraculous has ceased. Their claim to be filled with the Holy Ghost today is a claim that miraculous works are still being performed. Paul said all those things would cease, though, in 1 Corinthians 13. Whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease, and so forth. And so, when Revelation was completed, there was no further need of confirmation, miraculous confirmation, miraculous revelation. Miracles cease. Current claims of being filled with the Spirit identify today's claimants, whether they're claiming to be in the churches of Christ or not. It identifies them with people like Oral Roberts and Jan and Paul Crouch and Jimmy Swaggart and Kenneth Copeland and John Hagee and every other Pentecostal charlatan who plies his trade today. And they deny the confirmation of the truth. The folks at Tamarack Road in Altus, Oklahoma, Highland Oaks in Dallas, Farmers Branch, or West Link, any others who claim to be spirit-filled or to trust the Spirit for guidance ought to be able to demonstrate their claims in signs and wonders and divers miracles. As Brother Foy Wallace used to say, of such claims as goes the proposition, so must be the demonstration. Where is their proof? Next time someone tells you he's Spirit-filled, ask him to show you the proof. Those who claim to be filled with the Spirit commit fatal error by denying the all-sufficiency of God's Word, the cessation of miracles, and the confirmation of the truth.
If I am counting correctly, this is now the fourth instance of someone finishing ahead of time. Can the age of miracles really be over? Well, speaking of gifts, Jerry, you have given us a gift, and that's a gift of an excellent lesson. Thank you so much.